My dear doctor friends, today I am going to talk to you on a subject called osteoporosis. Osteoporosis is a hidden hazard. Most of the time, we do not realize that the patient is having osteoporosis until late in the time when the patient really suffers an osteoporotic fracture. And then we think of this grave condition. So let us see the important aspects of osteoporosis. Before we go into that, I will take you through quickly about the calcium and bone metabolism and homeostasis, and then we will go and see about osteoporosis. Please remember that bone is not a dead tissue, it is a living tissue, fully perfused with blood, and it is both strong and flexible, and it is not a constant pool of bone that we have. Every minute, every second, bone is being remodeled. Calcium is added and calcium is being removed. It is made up of collagen, calcium and phosphorus. Collagen is the supporting framework. Calcium and phosphorus together form the mineral matrix. The bone strength is determined by the bone density and by the bone quality. The density of the bone is the mineral and the quality of the bone is the collagen. In osteoporosis, both the quality as well as the density are affected. How does this bone remodeling occur? In the bone, we have got three types of cell lines. The osteoblasts, these are the depositing chunks of calcium into the bone. When there is an excessive osteoblastic activity, more and more calcium is drawn from the ECF and put and deposited as mineral matrix as calcium phosphate in the bone. The osteoclasts are a class of cells which are the withdrawal checks. When there is an excessive osteoclastic activity, the bone is resorbed and the calcium is released, and then it is secreted into the extracellular fluid or it leaks into the extracellular fluid. Then there are third type of cells called the osteocytes. What are these cells for? These cells are the mechanosensors. Osteocytes sense whether there is bone resorption is required or bone mineralization is required, whether osteoblastic activity should be more or osteoclastic activity should be more. So, the osteocytes sense what is happening in the extracellular fluid and what is happening at the level of bone and see if necessary bone deposition is required, mineral deposition is required in the bone, they promote the osteoblast. If more of mineral has to be moved away from the bone, they promote the osteoclast. The first two types of cells, that is the osteoblasts and the osteoclasts, they conduct the remodeling under the guidance and the triggering by the third group of cells, the osteocytes. The trabecular part of the bone and the cortical bone are the supporting structure of the bone, and they are the mineral, they are the matrix on which the minerals are deposited. How does the bone mass develop over the period of years in a man's age? When we are children, our bones are supple, they are soft, but the bones get mineralized and matrix is added and new bone is formed every day and the bone growth occurs until a peak bone mass of around 30 to 35 years. 85% of the bone mass is acquired by the age of 20 years. By 35 years, man or woman will have the peak bone mass. From then, the bone starts coming down in its density and volume, and this is possible only with the adequate intake of calcium throughout the childhood and adequate exercise in the formative years of life until the adulthood. So, the peak bone mass is achieved because of the adequate calcium intake throughout childhood and adolescence and through proper exercise. The bone mass starts declining from the age of 40 years. So, the yearly loss is around 1% in men above 50 years. Yearly bone loss up to 5% of the bone mass occurs in women after menopause. Look at this diagram here. After mid-30s, we begin to lose slowly the bone mass. Women lose bone mass faster after menopause, but it happens in men too. Don't think that loss of bone is only a feature in women. Bones can weaken early in life without a healthy diet and the right kind of physical activity. As you see here in the diagram, There is active bone growth in the formative years until the age of 30 years, and between 30 and 40 years the peak bone mass occurs. Then the blue area is the slow bone loss. Then the red area after 50 years is the rapid bone loss, and after 60-70s there is the less rapid bone loss. And this particular information is essential because for us to attain the peak bone mass, it is the nourishment and it is the physical activity in the formative years, in the early childhood, adolescence and adulthood. If we have good bones and have good bone mass, then naturally we are having the reserve to withstand the loss in the latter years. The definition of osteoporosis. Osteoporosis, international nomenclature abbreviation is OS. OS stands for osteoporosis. Hereafter, whenever you see OS on the slides, please read it as osteoporosis. Osteoporosis is a skeletal disorder characterized by compromised bone strength. And this compromised bone strength predisposes to increased risk of fractures. What is bone strength? Bone strength is, in effect, it is the bone density multiplied by the bone quality. Bone density is dependent upon the minerals, bone quality is dependent upon the matrix and the collagen. In osteoporosis, both the bone density as well as the bone quality are at fault. Osteoporosis, OS, is a systemic disease. It is not a disease confined to the bones alone. It is a systemic disease. It results in bone loss. There is both a qualitative and a quantitative loss of bone. The resultant easy predisposition to fractures with a little or no trauma or minor trauma results. Up to 20% of the bone loss occurs immediately after menopause. It is estimated that there will be a loss of 5% of bone every year after menopause. The resultant morbidity, mortality, quality adjusted life years of osteoporosis are tremendous. There is social and economic burden of osteoporosis on the society. The burden of osteoporosis. Osteoporosis is not a rare disorder. It is a major health hazard. It is estimated that 124 million Indians currently have or are at risk of osteoporosis. Among all the races on the globe, Asians and European women are more prone for osteoporosis. 80% of the osteoporosis cases, remember, are undiagnosed or hidden. 55% of the women and 40% of the men above the age of 50 years have significant bone loss. Half of these people suffer from fracture in their lifetime. So roughly around one quarter of people above the age of 50 years, either man or woman, will suffer a fracture due to osteoporosis. Is it not a grave figure? Is it not a tremendous health impact? Let us remember that this is a hidden health hazard for all of us. Look at the global burden of osteoporosis. Worldwide, there are 323 million fractures in the year 1990. 1.66 million are hip bone fractures alone due to osteoporosis. 1.55 billion fractures by 2050. 1.55 billion fractures by 2050. 6.2 million hip fractures alone due to osteoporosis by that time. Five times this number will have osteoporosis without fracture. 20% of the hip fracture patients die within the first year. 30 to 50% of them lose functionality after getting the fracture. These are very profound and are of enormous significance as far as the burden of osteoporosis on society is concerned. When we compare osteoporosis to other leading causes of mortality and morbidity, like the coronary events and the heart attacks, like the cerebrovascular events, the strokes and the breast cancer, we see the osteoporotic fractures are way above. 345,000 heart attacks, 373,000 strokes, 269,730 breast cancer patients versus 1,456,000 osteoporotic fractures. Of them, 383,000 vertebral fractures, 103,000 pelvic fractures, 415 fractures of other sides, 327,000 fractures of the wrist, and 223,000 fractures of the hip. Is it not enough for us to focus our attention on this large volume of morbidity caused by these osteoporotic fractures when we compare to other leading health hazards? What are the predisposing risk factors for osteoporosis? Lifestyle factors like low calcium and vitamin D intake, low body mass index of less than 19, thin frame, limited exercise from the time of childhood, smoking, excessive alcohol and excessive caffeine. Genetic factors like female gender, ethnic factors like Asian or European ethnicity, other genetic factors like vitamin D receptor genes, the procollagen gene and the chromosome 11 linked gene. And of course, increasing age, postmenopausal status, previous history of fracture, family history of an osteoporotic fracture. There are certain drugs which can cause osteoporosis and which can predispose to the risk of osteoporosis. These include the glucocorticoids, phenytoin, the anti-epileptic drug, and the thyroid hormones. These are some of the important risk factors for osteoporosis. Physical examination. Are there any tests to detect compression fractures of the vertebrae and the osteoporosis? Wall occiput distance is a marker of vertebral compression fracture. VCF stands for vertebral compression fracture. What is all wall occiput distance? Standing straight near the wall with the heels touching the wall and the occiput touching the wall. If you are able to touch the heel and the occiput to the wall, it's fine. There is no bending of the spine or the VCF. But if the wall occiput distance, also called WOD, is more than 3 centimeters, the positive predictive value for osteoporosis is 69%, negative predictive value is 79%. Whereas if the wall occiput distance is more than 7 centimeters, the positive predictive value for a vertebral compression fracture goes to as high as 92% and the negative predictive value to 76%. Consider OIS in fracture of any patient above the age of 50 years. Supposing you see a patient with fracture at the level of wrist in a patient of 50 years and above, the fundamental thing to be considered is underlying osteoporosis. Think of osteoporosis in women more than 50 years and in men more than 65 years. As per world x-rays to diagnose vertebral fracture, vertebral compression fractures. What are the different types of osteoporosis? In other words, what is the classification of osteoporosis? Postmenopausal OIS or postmenopausal osteoporosis is termed as PMO, also called as type 1 osteoporosis. Type 2 osteoporosis is called SOS or senile osteoporosis. These two come under the primary osteoporosis. There are a host of conditions which can produce osteoporosis secondary to their effects on bone and calcium metabolism. Glucocorticoid-induced osteoporosis is one such form of very common secondary osteoporosis and which is also called the GIO. Osteoporosis-associated fractures is another category. Osteopenia is not osteoporosis but the stage which is before the osteoporosis. The normal bone, the osteopenic bone, that is bone density is less than normal but not at osteoporotic, and then of course the osteoporosis. Then of course the osteoporosis related fracture with recurrent fractures or refractures. What is the pathogenesis of postmenopausal osteoporosis or type 1 osteoporosis? It starts with estrogen deficiency. And then that leads to increasing stimulation of osteoclasts and decreasing activity of the osteoblast receptors. So the osteoblastic function is reduced and the osteoclastic function is increased. Bone formation is reduced, bone withdrawal is increased. Bone calcium leaks into the extracellular fluid. There is an increase in the calcium in the extracellular fluid, and this increased calcium suppresses the parathyroid hormone secretion. Once the parathyroid hormone secretion is reduced, vitamin D3 maturation or vitamin D3 active form formation in the kidney is reduced. 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol is the active form of vitamin D, and which is done, this particular step of 125 dihydroxylation is done in the kidney under the influence of parathyroid hormone. In the absence or in the and the reduced levels of parathyroid hormone, formation of active vitamin D3 in the kidney is hampered. What does this lead to? When there is not much of active vitamin D3, intestinal calcium absorption comes down, and that leads to negative calcium balance, and that leads to postmenopausal osteoporosis. So estrogen deficiency, increasing bone resorption, decreasing bone formation, calcium leak into the extracellular fluid from the bone, increasing serum calcium, suppression of PTH, decreased formation of active vitamin D3 in the kidney, decreased intestinal reabsorption, negative calcium balance, postmenopausal osteoporosis. These are the chain of event. What's the mechanism for senile osteoporosis or SOS, also called type 2 osteoporosis? Decreased formation of 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol in the kidney. Because of increasing age, the kidney function comes down. This 25 dihydroxylated derivative of vitamin D3 is not converted into 125 dihydroxylated derivative, which is the active form of vitamin D3. This leads to a decreased intestinal calcium absorption, and that leads to decreased parathyroid hormone secretion, and that increased parathyroid hormone secretion allows the bone calcium to be withdrawn, and bone calcium leaks into the extracellular fluid, then more amount of bone reabsorption, negative calcium balance, and senile osteoporosis. GIO, glucocorticoid induced osteoporosis. Common iatrogenic osteoporosis also comes under the secondary osteoporosis. At least 3 to 6 months of continuous exposure to glucocorticoids is required to cause GIO. It doesn't occur with 3 days course or 1 week course of glucocorticoids. So don't be afraid to use steroids in short bursts, but long term use of steroids, particularly oral steroids, is the culprit. Inhaled steroids, hitherto they were thought to be very, very safe as far as osteoporosis is concerned, but now the evidence states that inhaled steroids in high doses of more than 400 to 800 micrograms of budesonide or other forms of inhaled steroids may cause osteoporosis, secondary osteoporosis due to glucocorticoids. Oral steroid use commonly done for chronic bronchial asthma, chronic skin conditions, COPD, rheumatoid arthritis, inflammatory bowel disease, and several other conditions which require chronic steroid use, and those patients should be closely monitored for the development of GIO. 50% of the patients who receive long-term steroids suffer from osteoporosis and related fractures. So we must consider doing a bone mineral density in all those patients who are on chronic steroid therapy. And also we should consider giving drug therapy with bisphosphonates to mineralize the bone to prevent the glucocorticoid induced osteoporosis. Sometimes it is not possible to stop the glucocorticoids because the very underlying disease demands the use of glucocorticoids on a long and continued basis. In such a case, do the bone mineral density, assess the osteoporotic status, consider drug therapy to remineralize the bone, particularly with bisphosphonates. What is the pathogenesis or pathophysiology of GIO? Glucocorticoids, when used in long-term basis of 3 to 6 months in large doses, particularly oral steroids, they decrease the adrenal androgens, they decrease the testosterones, they decrease the estrogens. All these, remember, are also protective hormones. Adrenal androgens, testosterone and estrogens are bone forming hormones, anabolic hormones for the bone. So this results in increase in the osteocytic apoptosis. This increase in the osteocytic apoptosis decreases the osteoblastic bone formation. And that osteoblastic bone formation, once it is decreased, it will result in osteoporosis. The other thing is, the decrease in the adrenal androgens, testosterone, estrogens together increase the osteoclastic bone resorption. Osteoclastic bone resorption paves way for osteoporosis. Thus, there is a two-pronged attack. There is a reduction in the bone formation, there is an increase in the bone resorption. The net result is loss of bone mass or osteoporosis. And these glucocorticoids that decrease the gastrointestinal calcium absorption, they increase the urinary excretion of calcium, they decrease thus the available serum calcium. When there is an decreased serum calcium, there is a feedback stimulation of parathyroid hormone. The excess parathyroid hormone acts on the bone to resorb the calcium from the bone and put it in the extracellular fluid. And that results in osteoclastic bone resorption and goes on to osteoporosis. What are the tests that we do for identifying secondary causes of osteoporosis? Complete blood count with ESR. Look for the parathyroid hormone levels, look for calcium levels and phosphorus levels, and the kidney function by way of creatinine, liver function by doing alkaline phosphatase, SGOT, SGPT and serum albumin, thyroid function particularly TSH in the fasting state, testosterone levels in men, estradiol, FSH and androgens in women, estimation of urinary calcium and free cortisol in the urine, protein electrophoresis of serum for multiple myeloma. These are some of the important tests to understand if there is any secondary cause of osteoporosis operating in a particular patient. We often talk of osteoporotic fractures. What are the common sites of osteoporotic fractures? The hip bone, particularly the neck of the femur. Vertebral compression fractures, also called VCL. Thoracic and lumbar regions are the most commonly affected regions for osteoporotic vertebral compression fractures. It is not the cervical. It is mostly the lower thoracic and the upper lumbar regions due to bending activities on an already compromised osteoporotic vertebral bodies. The Colles fracture or the distal radial fracture, because when they fall, they land on the hand and try to take support with the hand, the weak radial bone, the distal end of the radius gives way and produces Colles fracture. Sometimes the proximal humerus, proximal tibia, the pelvic bone, the malleolar bone of the ankle are also involved in osteoporotic fracture. Look at this bar graph showing the proportion of people with vertebral deformity. The green bars represent men and the red bars represent women. Between the ages of 50 and 59, the people, proportion of people with vertebral deformity in both men and women is almost same, around 18%. But in the age group of 60 to 69, the women outnumber men by almost double the number of patients. Then in the age of 70 and 79, again there is a female excess. Around 40% of the women and around 30% of the men have vertebral deformity. But when you come to the age of 80 to 86, this difference is annulled, and both women and men, whatever may be the sex, around 60% of the people in the age group 80 to 86 have vertebral deformity. These are preventable, remember, in the early stages. If we identify the osteoporosis, if we correct the osteoporosis, then certainly the vertebral deformity can be delayed and probably even prevented. As we have already seen, the three major sites of osteoporosis related fractures are the hip, the spine, particularly the lower thoracic and the lumbar spine, the wrist, lower end of the radius and the Colles fracture, and of course, if you put together all three of them, the red bar represents fractures due to all causes. What is the risk of osteoporosis related hip fractures? remember, more than the combined lifetime risk of breast, uterine and ovarian cancers put together, the risk of hip fracture due to osteoporosis outshines, outnumbers the above three cancers. Okay, we may think that if we have a hip fracture, if a patient suffers a fracture of the hip, there are modern treatments, so one can get back to normal life. But it is not the case. If 100 people suffer hip fracture due to osteoporosis, 50% of them lose functional ability to properly walk and conduct their daily activities, which is horrible. 20% of them die in the first year after the fracture due to either recurrent fracture or due to the complications of fracture and bedridden nature and other associated fractures. And only 30% of the patients who have a hip fracture will have full functional recovery and will be able to do their pre-fracture functional activities. So to say, 70% of the people are incapacitated, either functional incapacity or by death. So it's a very important morbidity and mortality that hip fractures throw. And so one has to be very much aware of the possibility of osteoporosis related hip fractures, and at the first instance osteoporosis itself, and identify, screen for those people, identify the risk factors and prevent the OIS and the OIS related hip fracture and other fractures. Osteoporosis related hip fractures, 250,000 hip fractures every year, 25% excess mortality each year due to hip fractures, 65,000 Indians females die per year due to hip fracture, 50% of those with hip fractures are permanently disabled, 20% of them require LTC, long term care. Tremendous burden on the society. Look at a patient who cannot walk, who is confined to the wheelchair, who is confined to the bed, and a person who has to use walking aids. Their life is miserable. They are always dependent on others, and the society, the family, everyone is affected by those who have these functional incapacities, including the patient. This is the summary chart showing the importance of osteoporosis in terms of the occupancy of hospital bed days. Bed days here represent number of days spent by the patient on the bed per 1000 women in the age group of 45 and above. 45 days are spent by these women due to hip fracture, due to diabetes 22 days, due to COPD 30 days, due to myocardial infarction 34 days, due to breast cancer 38 days. If you look at all these things, hip fractures contribute to the major number of bed occupancy days in terms of comparing to other morbidities like diabetes, COPD, myocardial infarction and breast cancer. This again underscores the importance of osteoporosis related hip fractures, which make the patient confined to the bed. Does fracture risk increase with aging? Certainly yes. Look at this graph, 35 years, 45 years, 50 years, very stable. There is no increasing risk either for vertebral, hip or coalis fracture until the age of around 50 years. From the age of 50 years, the vertebral fracture risk starts exponentially increasing. The risk for hip fracture starts increasing from 55 years and also very steeply climbs. Risk for coalis fracture also starts increasing, but not to the same extent as the other two. Look at the bone structure in both normal and osteoporotic bone. On the left hand side, we have the picture of a normal bone with good matrix, good mineralization and little bit of porosity and not much. Whereas on the other side, on the right hand side, you see an osteoporotic bone with very big osteoporotic areas. Bone framework is disturbed, trabeculae are thinned out, and then there is the mineralization is less, the matrix is reduced and the bone looks very porous. This is a picture of a very severe osteoporotic bone, femur. You can see almost the bone is totally eroded, as though something has eaten away the bone, and the bone looks very fragile, vulnerable for fracture, and totally eroded and demineralized. Lot of osteoclastic activity and very little osteoblastic activity or bone forming activity in this bone. So in the young, on the top left hand side of the picture, you have the vertebrae of the young man. The vertebral body is very densely packed, the trabeculae are well formed, the porosity is less. But in the elderly, on the contrary, the vertebral body collapses. You can see the concavities on both sides of the vertebral body. There is increasing porosity, the trabeculae are thinned out, bone density is reduced. On the right hand side, you see the x-ray of the patient who has got severe osteoporosis of the spine, and you see the two lower thoracic vertebrae being subject to vertebral compression fractures or VCF, and you see the wedge-shaped vertebrae instead of a fully formed square-like vertebrae, you have the wedge-like vertebrae, as you can see here in this radiograph. These are the physiological changes that occur in the vertebral bodies and with vertebral fractures as man ages. In the young, the skeleton, you can see on the extreme left part of the picture, the spine is very erect, there is no collapse of the spine or any vertebral compression fracture. But as age ages, the height gets reduced, there is compression fracture of the vertebral bodies, either in the thoracic or in the upper lumbar region. And further down on the right, extreme right hand side picture, you can see severe kyphosis of the spine with bending of the spine and loss of height. The same patient's skeleton, there is a loss of height of around 2 to 6 centimeters due to vertebral compression fractures and osteoporosis. Look at this woman. On the left hand side, we have her picture at 40 years, where there is no vertebral bending, there is no vertebral collapse, there is not much of osteoporosis. But due to aging, in a matter of around 30-35 years, when she is 75, there is kyphosis, there is VCF, vertebral compression fracture, there is loss of height. This is what happens when the bones are demineralized and the osteoporosis sets in. Who should have bone mineral density testing? The WHO, WHO. These are the recommendations by the World Health Organization for undergoing a bone mineral density testing. Anyone suffering a pathological fracture, irrespective of the age, anyone with loss of height of more than 2 inches or vertebral compression fracture or kyphosis or hump, women aged 60 years, men aged 65 years, diabetes of more than 5 years, postmenopausal women less than 60 years also, if they have one or two other risk factors for osteoporosis, patients who are on glucocorticoid therapy or who have a previous history of treatment, patients who are considered for drug therapy with glucocorticoids or phenytoin or other drugs which are supposed to produce osteoporosis. And it is required for follow-up of all patients who are on treatment for osteoporosis. So these are, in nutshell, the recommendations for undergoing bone mineral density testing for a given patient. So we have to look for such patients and refer them for BMD test. What are the advantages of bone mineral density testing? Bone mineral density values follow a normal distribution, the bell-shaped curve with a mean and the spread to on either sides. Mean BMD decreases with age, both in men and women. BMD is inversely related to the fracture risk. The lower the bone mineral density, the higher is the risk for the fracture. WHO has adopted bone mineral density to define the cutoff values for osteoporosis. Asymptomatic osteoporosis can be diagnosed before it becomes symptomatic and leads to fracture. Bone mineral density is effective in predicting osteoporotic fractures. It has got good sensitivity and high specificity, so that it's a test which can be applied in clinical setting. But now we have to see what are the methods of assessing bone mineral density or BMD. What are the shortcomings of BMD? BMD values are site specific. That means the BMD values of calcaneum, BMD values at the femoral neck, BMD values at the lumbar or thoracic spine will not be the same. They will be different. But of course, we will be guided by the worst BMD value in a given patient to classify him for the risk of osteoporosis or fracture. Exposure technique also plays a role in deciding the density of the bone, because it is a radiograph almost. X-ray radiation is passed, and then the exposure technique will play a role in giving the estimate of BMD. BMD is decreased not only in osteoporosis, it is also decreased in osteomalacia. It cannot differentiate between primary osteoporosis and secondary osteoporosis. We need other tests to find out whether it is a primary osteoporosis or secondary osteoporosis. Patient management is to be based on clinical features and not on BMD alone. So, these are some of the important aspects which we need to keep in mind when we interpret a BMD. WHO has proposed to use T-score of the BMD. What is this T-score? T-score allows us to compare different patients. It allows us to classify a given patient into different categories. T-score is worked as follows. T-score is equal to patient BMD minus bone mineral density of young adult of the same sex divided by the standard deviation of the BMD in the young adult of the same sex. So, by this we know we get a number, and that number is called the T-score. If that number is between minus 1 and plus 1 standard deviation, then it is within the normal BMD range. So, if the T-score is between minus 1 and minus 2.5, that is far removed to the left, then it is osteopenia or deficiency in the bone mineralization. Then comes the stage of osteoporosis, where the T-score is beyond 2.5 standard deviations on the minus side, that is minus 2.5 standard deviations or lower. This is called osteoporosis. If this is associated with fracture, it is called severe osteoporosis. A BMD score of minus 2.5 standard deviations or lower with associated fractures is classified as severe osteoporosis. The next slide will illustrate the concept of this T-score in a little bit clearer way. So, the peak bone mass occurs around 30 to 35 years, and let us say that is the mean or the central part of the curve, of the bell-shaped curve, and we call it as 0 point. From there, one standard deviation towards the left, that is minus 1, 0 to minus 1. If the patient value T-score falls anywhere between 0 to minus 1, then we classify him to be in the normal range. Supposing the patient value of T-score falls between minus 1 and minus 2.5, that is to the left of the normal range, and that is called osteopenia or reduced bone density. Not at osteoporosis, but it is not normal, it is reduced bone density. But patients whose T-score is less than minus 2.5, that is much more towards the left of the osteopenia, that stage is called the osteoporosis. So, a T-score of anything less than minus 2.5 is osteoporosis, minus 1 to minus 2.5 is osteopenia, 0 to minus 1 is normal. So, a patient who has got osteoporosis with T-score of less than minus 2.5, if he has got an associated fracture, osteoporotic fracture, and he or she is classified as having severe osteoporosis. So, this is how we have to interpret the T-score as per the WHO guidelines. How do we measure the bone mineral density? What are the various tests that are available or gadgets that are available for us to measure the bone mineral density or BMD? The procedures are called densitometry or measuring the density of the bone. The options available are DEXA, called the DEXA scan, dual energy X-ray absorptiometry, simply called as DEXA. The sexa scan, not the sex scan, it is a sexa scan, single energy X-ray absorptiometry, and the P-DEXA, small p there, portable DEXA scan, and the quantitative ultrasound using a normal ultrasound probe quantifying the mineral density, and then of course the lastly QCT or quantitative computed tomography. So to summarize the test, DEXA, SEXA, PDEXA, QUS and QCT. So we will see in the next slide how to apply this test and when to apply this test and what are the relative advantages of each of these. This picture illustrates central DEXA scan machine with the patient laying on the table and his vertebral BMD is being computed, and you can see on the computer screen the vertebral bone mineral density being charted out. And of course, one has to look at least minimum of three sites: the vertebral site, the femoral neck, the distal radius. These are the minimum three sites taken. And of course, if necessary, depending on any other fractures, one need to look at the BMD or the fracture site or other sites where there are symptoms. This table summarizes the different modalities of densitometry and the relative advantages. DEXA, dual energy X-ray absorptiometry, the gold standard test for bone mineral density. Reproducibility is excellent, versatility is excellent, it can be used on all the bones. Of course, the cost is around 2000 rupees per DEXA scan, and the radiation hazard is minimal. Whereas if you use a SEXA scan, single energy X-ray absorptiometry, the reproducibility is less, it is not universally available, cost is same as the DEXA, but the radiation is more. The portable DEXA, reproducibility is less, versatility not available always, though the cost may be a little less, and again radiation is less because it is P-DEXA. The quantitative ultrasound, reproducibility is comparatively less, it is not versatile to be applied for all the bones. The cost of course is the lowest, and there is of course absolutely no radiation because it is an ultrasound that we use. The P-DEXA and the QUS may be used for screening purposes. The QCT or the quantitated computerized tomography is helpful in obese patients to scan the spine. The QCT is sophisticated and very accurate, but it is costly. It costs around 5000 rupees per test. So, obviously the best choice would be DEXA, and the screening tools are P-DEXA and QUS. SEXA scan doesn't come into picture because cost is high and comparatively it is not doing a good job. Whereas QCT is reserved for those extreme group of patients for whom DEXA is not able to give any good information because of obesity, and in such situations, though it is costly, QCT may have to be done. Are there any contraindications for DEXA scan? Pregnancy, of course, is a contraindication because we use X-rays. This is a double energy X-ray absorptiometry. So, we have to compare the risk versus benefit, and if the risk versus benefit ratio is in favor of the patient, then probably we order a DEXA scan, or else we postpone the DEXA scan until the time of delivery. Recent GI contrast studies, recent we mean less than 72 hours, will interfere with the interpretation of BMD scores. Likewise, recent nuclear medicine tests like radionuclear study of the thyroids or the kidneys or the bones or any other organs will interfere with the study of DEXA because the BMD values are confounded by the nuclear material available in the system. Of course, excessive obesity is not a contraindication, but people with excessive weight of more than 110 kilograms, we will not be able to get the correct BMD scores, BMD values, and it will not be correctly interpretable and classifiable because of the excessive obesity. A 3-4% shift in the BMD values in follow-up are very significant. Follow-up is required every 6 months in cases of osteoporosis, and in every 2 years for cases of osteopenia. Only central DEXA should be used for monitoring therapy. No ultrasound, no SEXA, no QCT, and no PDEXA. It is only the central DEXA that has to be used for monitoring the treatment. The World Health Organization has given 5 important steps for the prevention of osteoporosis. Step 1 is, all of us should get our daily recommended amount of vitamin D and calcium in our diet, either in the diet or by supplementation. So what are the recommendations? We will see a little later in the next slide. The first step for everyone is to see that adequate amounts of calcium and vitamin D are included and provided in the diet. The step 2 is, engage in regular weight-bearing exercises. Weight-bearing exercises does not mean going to the gym and lifting 50 kilograms or 100 kilograms of weight. Simple activities such as walking, stair climbing, or dancing, or doing a little bit of household work or gardening can increase the weight, bone mass, and they are termed as weight-bearing exercises. They will strengthen the bones. The third important step for prevention of osteoporosis is avoid smoking. Avoid smoking. Tell me what disease smoking does not cause, including osteoporosis. So, at any cost, one must give up smoking, and also alcohol excess should be avoided. Here we say excess, patients will start taking alcohol in the regular quantities. Better we emphasize that smoking and alcohol abstinence is essential. Then if they have an occasional drink, probably it may not affect, but we shouldn't suggest the patient, okay, alcohol in moderation is good, only in excess it is dangerous. That's not going to be really conveying the message that alcohol is detrimental to the bones. The step 4 for prevention is to counsel about bone health. When the patient comes to us, we should tell that preserving the bones is important. And bones do deteriorate with age, and we have methods of identifying people who are at greater risk and who can be screened and who can be prevented from developing poor bones and poor bone related fractures. So this has to be counseled and emphasized, and patients should be encouraged to ask about these things, and we should tell them the importance of strong bones, particularly as age advances. The fifth or the final step is to have a bone densitometry or bone density test or BMD test and take medication whenever it's appropriate. This testing is non-invasive, very simple, painless procedure and not highly expensive. We have seen the different types, modalities of testing and types of instruments. DEXA scan is the best one, and we have also seen the guidelines who are the people who should be recommended to have a bone mineral density tested. So thus, these 5 steps, to summarize again, the diet, the exercise, and then the counseling by the doctor, and identifying the patients who are at risk and submitting them for bone mineral density testing are the important steps that one need to take, in addition to most important aspect like giving up smoking and all. Remember, it is the calcium in our diet, it is the calcium supplementation if necessary that we take, and it is the vitamin D containing foods that we take, or it is the vitamin D supplementation that we take, or the vitamin D we manufacture through our skin that matter a lot for the bone strength of ours. What are the foods which are very rich in calcium? Fruit juices, orange juice, broccoli, all green vegetables, they contain good amounts of calcium. But the most important group of the diet or the food group that contains calcium is that are the dairy products or the milk group. 8 ounces of yogurt or around 200 ml of yogurt contains around 35% of the daily requirement of calcium. Milk, whole milk, 2% milk, 1% milk, skimmed milk, chocolate milk, 1 cup of milk gives 30% of daily requirement of calcium. So, if we can drink around 3 cups of milk a day, it suffices mostly to the needs of daily requirement of calcium. Like similarly, you can see the other foods, dairy foods that are listed here, and the daily requirement provided by the food group like cheese, milk pudding, frozen yogurt, ice cream, soy milk, things like that. But most important, remember that we require to take dairy products. But when we take dairy products, one problem that could come up is the fat. So we require to boil the milk very well, remove the fat portion of it, or use skim milk or low fat milk, so that the negative or bad part of the dairy products is avoided. The good part of the dairy products like vitamin D and calcium and other calories and other nutrients are available. Calcium requirement is met with by using dairy products. So dairy products, green leafy vegetables, fruit juices, these three together form the main food items which contribute to the calcium in their diet. Remember, chemically given calcium like a calcium tablet form is not the best source. The best source is food, because food items, once you start taking the food items for calcium, you also get other nutrients associated with that. The absorption is much better as of calcium in the food compared to plain calcium available pharmacologically. So food is the best source of calcium. Another interesting and important point is we should not load the system or the GI tract with the whole calcium required per day. Let's say the calcium requirement is around 1000 milligrams per day. We should not try and push the entire calcium in one meal or in one tablet. It is better it is divided into two or three parts, and we take the calcium as 300 milligrams each time. Then the absorption of calcium is much better, and body can at best handle about 500 milligrams of calcium at one time. So either from food or supplements. So consume calcium sources throughout the day, and not all at one time. Most of us are compulsive coffee drinkers. Excessive caffeine in the coffee can increase the urinary calcium excretion, thereby lead to negative calcium balance. So it's better to limit to 400 milligrams of caffeine per day. So about 6 ounces of coffee gives 100 milligrams of caffeine. 6 ounces is around 150 ml. 40 milligrams of caffeine is present in 6 ounces of regularly brewed tea, and maybe less in the green tea. Some soft drinks have comparable levels of caffeine to the tea, and some medications also do have caffeine. So excess caffeine will result in increase in the urinary calcium excretion, thereby depleting the total calcium pool of the body, and thus allowing us to go for negative calcium balance, which may result in osteoporosis. This fact has to be kept in mind for those people who drink coffee more number of times than once or twice a day. How about the intake of excessive sodium? The more sodium is taken, as table salt or common salt we use, when the sodium goes to the kidney and the excess sodium is filtered, it has to be reabsorbed. When the sodium has to be reabsorbed, it has to be exchanged for calcium. So more amount of calcium goes out for the excess sodium to be absorbed back into the system. So if we reduce the salt intake, the load of salt on the kidney is less, so load to reabsorb is less, so load for calcium excretion becomes less. So the calcium is not excreted and calcium is conserved. So excess sodium intake leads to excess urinary calcium excretion. Food and Nutrition Board recommends a limit of not more than 2400 milligrams of salt per day. So let us try and restrict to sodium intake to around 2 or 2.5 grams at the most per day. Alcohol is documented to produce bone loss. Consuming alcohol is associated with greater risk of low bone density, associated osteoporosis, propensity for fall because of the drink, and with the fall and with the osteoporosis, greater risk for fractures. Fruits and vegetables. For everything that is good, we require more intake of fruits and vegetables. Calcium is no exception. Bone strength requires adequate intake of fruits and vegetables. The food pyramid guidelines recommend 2 to 4 servings of fruits per day and 3 to 5 servings of vegetables per day to improve and to maintain the bone mineral density at optimum level. Prevention of falls. In elderly people and people with osteoporosis, postmenopausal women, men over 65 years, it is essential that we emphasize on prevention of falls. If a fall occurs or if a minor trauma occurs, it can lead to osteoporosis or osteoporotic fractures. Home safety measures, bathroom safety measures, outdoor safety measures are essential. Hip pads, see the diagram, the hip pads for women and the self-sitting hip pads, the hip pads of men for men worn along with the undergarments, they will take the impact when a person falls and will not allow the trochanter to directly land and have an impact. With the result, the fracture neck of femur is prevented by wearing these hip pads. Exercise, particularly weight bearing exercise, muscle strengthening exercise of 3 to 4 times per week for a minimum period of 30 or more minutes. It's important to take care to avoid injury, because while having the enthusiasm to put the patient on exercise, we should not subject the patient to excess chance for fall and injury, which might itself result in a fracture. We should encourage all old people to climb the stairs at least 2 or 3 times a day. Of course, they should use the railings to prevent themselves from falling. And relieving the symptoms of fracture and deformity is essential, because that puts them back on walking and other forms of exercise. And try and improve the mobility and function of the person so that they can come back to normal life and have some amount of physical exercise. The woman here, woman in the right hand side picture, is doing what is called the balancing exercise. So try and keep the balance on one foot with a good hold of the counter to start with, and slowly leave the hold, just touching the hold with one finger, then repeat the exercise on the opposite foot, and thus give a balancing weight bearing exercise to the hip muscles and to the hip bone. And of course, while doing the balancing act, we should encourage the patient to lift off the other foot from the ground and bend it at the knee at right angles, as shown in this picture. Fall prevention in home. Use handrails on staircases, in the bathrooms. Keep something to hold, some handles in the bathroom, so that when the old people use the bathroom, they will be able to grasp something before they really fall. Keep rooms free of clutter, particularly wires. Keep floor surfaces clean but not very slippery. Wear supportive low-heeled chappals or shoes. Do not walk in socks or floppy slippers. Use good lighting like incandescent lights or 100 watt bulb lights. Install ceiling lighting in the bedrooms other than table lights or standing lights or things like that. Ceiling lights will throw a good light on the floor. With the result, old people will be able to see what is there on the floor and make proper adjustments. Use rubber mats in the shower and the tub, so that the flooring is not wet and doesn't lead to fall. Keep a flashlight at bedside. When they get up from the bed in darkness, they must have enough light, and the torchlight or the flashlight will be a good handy resource for them to show the way to the bathroom or to the other parts of the room, thus can prevent them from falling. Check the posture in the mirror very often. If you find that something is strange, ask for help, because there could be an invisible fracture that is there in the spine. So this is how we have to educate the patient to prevent the falls at home. What are the therapeutic goals for us in a patient of osteoporosis? Try and decrease the risk of fracture. Maintain the bone integrity, maintain the bone mass, prevent bone loss, and regulate the bone turnover. Relieve the symptoms of fracture and deformity. and improve the morbidity and function of the patient. The available treatment options are calcium and vitamin D supplementations, hormone replacement therapy, HRT, or estrogen replacement therapy, ERT, low dose estrogen therapy, bisphosphonates, a new class of drugs which have revolutionized the treatment of osteoporosis. We will see a lot about them in the succeeding slides. Selective estrogen receptor modulators, SERM. These are a new class of compounds which act on the selectively on the receptors of estrogens in the bone without acting on the receptors of estrogen in the uterus and the breast. So, giving SERMs will have an advantage over giving estrogens directly. Androgens, calcitonin and the other future treatment options, all these will be discussed. How much of calcium do we need every day? What is the daily requirement of calcium? In growing children, it is around 800 to 1200 milligrams. In teens and youngsters, 1200 to 1500 milligrams, that is the time when more bone formation is occurring. In women between 25 to 50 years, 1000 milligrams. Men between 25 to 60 years, 1000 milligrams. Postmenopausal women on hormone replacement therapy, 1000 milligrams. Postmenopausal women not on HRT, 1500 milligrams. Men and women over the age of 65, 1500 milligrams. Pregnant and lactating mothers, 1200 to 1500 milligrams. In other words, at the minimum, we require around 1000 milligrams of calcium per day. At the maximum, we require around 1500 milligrams of calcium per day in people who are elderly, who are at a higher risk, who are pregnant and lactating, and who are growing children. So, around 1000 milligrams to 1500 milligrams of calcium will be required by us. A word about the ERT and HRT. ERT is estrogen replacement therapy, HRT is the hormone replacement therapy. What are the contraindications or dangers with these ERT or HRT? Intolerance to estrogens, increase in the risk of invasive breast cancer, increase in the risk of deep venous thrombosis and pulmonary embolism, increased risk of stroke and CVA, increased risk of hypertension, coronary artery disease, and increased risk of gallbladder disease. So, in view of these things, it is not a routine that everyone should get ERT or HRT. One has to outweigh the risks compared to the benefits and then only start thinking of replacing these hormones in postmenopausal women. HRT regimen of 0.625 milligrams of CEE plus 2.5 milligrams of medroxyprogesterone, lower doses of estrogens of 0.3 to 0.4 are being tried. Bisphosphonates, these are new introductions into the field of treatment of osteoporosis and bone disorders. Bisphosphonates are new generation compounds. They affect the balance of bone metabolism. Remember, they are not hormones or hormone supplements or vitamin D related drugs. They bind tightly and inhibit the osteoclastic bone resorption. Bisphosphonates, when given, they go and bind to the osteoclast and inhibit their osteoclastic bone resorption activity, and the net result, bone formation will take over the bone resorption. They increase the bone mineral density at spine as well as the hip. Their efficacy is equal to the administration of estrogens in good doses without the side effects of the hormones. Randomized clinical trials have shown that 30 to 50% reduction in fractures, including the hip fractures, occurs in those people who are treated with bisphosphonates compared to those who are not given bisphosphonates. Bone loss will resume after the discontinuation of therapy. That means the effect of bisphosphonates is transient and not permanent. As long as you give the bisphosphonates, the osteoclasts are under check, the osteoclasts are inhibited and bone resorption is stopped. But once you remove the bisphosphonates, the osteoclastic activity again comes back and then you have a negative bone mass or increased bone turnover. So bisphosphonates are as drugs should be continued to have their benefits acquired to the patient. Let's look at the indications for bisphosphonates. Indications are to prevent bone loss in postmenopausal women, to treat established PMO, postmenopausal osteoporosis, to treat glucocorticoid induced osteoporosis along with calcium supplementation. They have a role in other bone disorders like Paget's disease and the malignancies of bone, where there is excessive osteoclastic activity and bone resorption occurring. Bisphosphonates do have a role. Of course, they have a role in treatment of hypercalcemia also, which we will discuss at a later stage. The contraindications of bisphosphonates: active upper GI disease like upper GI bleed, GI ulcers, dyspepsia and other things. Hypocalcemia is itself a contraindication. Renal insufficiency is a relative contraindication for bisphosphonate. These drugs have to be administered carefully and they require some methodology to administer. These have to be taken, oral bisphosphonates have to be taken 30 minutes before breakfast, and they should be taken with a full tumbler of plain water. And the patient needs to be in the erect position for at least an hour for the bisphosphonates to be absorbed properly. The various bisphosphonates are available: alendronate, risedronate, etidronate, ibandronate. Out of them, alendronate, risedronate are available in the oral form. Alendronate can be given as 10 milligrams per day or 70 milligrams long acting per week orally. Risedronate can be given as 5 milligrams on a daily basis or as 35 milligrams long acting per week orally. Etidronate is an injectable form to be given cyclically. Ibandronate to be given once in a month as IV injection of 0.5 to 2 milligrams dissolved in normal saline and given as an IV drip for over half an hour to 45 minutes. Selective estrogen receptor modulators or SERMs. They bind to estrogen receptor and exert an estrogen like effect on the bone. We know that estrogen is anabolic on the bone. These drugs act like estrogen and are anabolic to the bone, but these drugs do not get attached to the receptors in the uterus or the breast. So much so, there is no excess uterine cancer, there is no excess risk of breast cancer with the use of SERMs. But if we use estrogens, they may protect the bone, but they may harm the uterus and the breast and also the cardiovascular health. Whereas SERMs have no effect on the cardiovascular health, they have no increase documented on the uterine front or on the breast cancer front. They have a bone sparing or bone forming or anabolic effect on the bone because they bind and exert the estrogen like effect onto the estrogen receptors available on the bone. They can increase bone mineral density up to 30 to 50% and decrease the spinal fracture rates very much, but they have no effect on hip or other fractures from the randomized controlled trials. They can be used in the prevention and treatment of postmenopausal osteoporosis. They are contraindicated in patients with history of venous thromboembolism. They may cause, like estrogens, hot flushes, leg cramps and DVT. They interact with warfarin, which needs to be closely monitored when the people are put on SERM. There are a number of selective estrogen receptor modulators also called SERMs: raloxifene, tamoxifen, levomeloxifen, idoxifene, draloxifen. Of these, raloxifene and tamoxifen are very commonly used agents. These have a mixed estrogen agonist and antagonistic activity. On the bone, they stimulate the estrogens, they occupy the estrogen receptors and stimulate the estrogen mediated action on the bone and increase the bone mineral density and reduce the osteoporosis. On the uterus and the breast, they have an antagonistic activity, and hence they will not lead to increased incidence of breast cancer or uterine cancer. Calcitonin. Calcitonin is a peptide hormone produced from the C cells of the thyroid gland. The C cells also are called the chief cells of the thyroid gland, and this peptide hormone has got 32 amino acids. It inhibits the osteoclastic activity and decreases the bone resorption. Calcitonin helps in moving the calcium from the extracellular environment into the bone. This is available as nasal spray. Nasal spray of human calcitonin or salmon calcitonin is available. The dosage is 200 international units daily as nasal spray, and it is also available in the injectable form of 1 ml ampules, each ml containing 100 international units to be injected subcutaneously. The suppositories of calcitonin are available, but they are weak in their action because of poor absorption from the rectal mucosa. The actions of calcitonin are exactly opposite to the actions of parathyroid hormone. Parathyroid hormone increases the osteoclastic activity, produces secretion of calcium from the bone into the extracellular milieu, whereas human calcitonin or salmon calcitonin, it decreases the osteoclastic activity, increases the bone mineral density, moves the calcium from the ECF into the bone. The availability of PTHRP and the synthetic parathyroid hormone teriparatide, Forteo, is a miracle now as far as the treatment of bone diseases are concerned. Look at the two images. The image on the left is before the treatment with parathyroid hormone. Totally osteoporotic, very thin trabeculae, and bone mineral density is very much reduced. Daily injections of PTHRP or teriparatide for over a period of 1 year. Look at the bone on the right hand side. Thick, trabeculae are totally strengthened, and then the osteoporosis disappeared. Then the bone mineral density has increased considerably. So now we have two miracle drugs, either the PTHRP, or that is parathyroid hormone related peptide, or the synthetic parathyroid hormone called the teriparatide. So either one of them can be used for the treatment of severe osteoporosis, particularly senile osteoporosis and postmenopausal osteoporosis or glucocorticoid induced osteoporosis. So my dear friends, we come to the concluding slide. Remember, osteoporosis is a preventable disease. Good peak bone mass should be attained in the early formative years of life until adulthood. Only then the bones will be stronger in the old age. Remember, osteoporosis is not simply an aging process like graying of hair. It is a disease by itself, which leads to several complications, including functional immobility, osteoporotic fractures, and mortality. So it has to be identified and should be corrected, and fractures prevented. Excellent technology is now in place for measuring the bone mineral density, unlike around 10 to 15 years ago. We have the DEXA scan, central DEXA, and the peripheral DEXA, and the ultrasound QUS, and the QCT in those cases which require. But mostly, it is the central DEXA scan that is the gold standard for doing the bone mineral density testing and estimating the T-scores. Persons at risk can be identified using clinical parameters and bone mineral density testing, and they can be treated with different pharmacological and dietary approaches. Modern treatment based on randomized controlled clinical trials is available. Bisphosphonates, selective estrogen receptor modulators, synthetic parathyroid hormone, vitamin D analogs and several newer therapies including calcitonin are now available. Calcium intake right through the lifetime, particularly in the growing phase and in the old age after the menopause and in the advancing years, is essential to maintain bone integrity and bone structure and bone strength. Exercise, particularly weight bearing exercise, is essential and its importance cannot be overemphasized. Please think of yourself with a fracture of the hip or fracture of the vertebra and how incapacitating it would be for the individual, for the family and for the society to have people who are bedridden, who are invalid, who have to be carried in wheelchairs, who cannot walk, who cannot take care of themselves and who cannot be productive in their life. So let us remember that this fracture risk is nothing but the end stage of osteoporosis. If we identify risk factors for osteoporosis, we can prevent osteoporosis. If we identify people with osteoporosis, we can prevent them from becoming patients of fracture and invalidity. So this is the final call to all of us to open our eyes and look for all the associated risk factors necessary to produce osteoporosis and treat osteoporosis and osteopenia vigorously and prevent fractures. Let us understand that this is the punchline. If we support our bones, the bones support us. Osteoporosis awareness program, all the physicians must be sensitized, must be adequately informed about this hidden hazard, osteoporosis, the risk factors, the identification of patients with risk factors, particularly the elderly, particularly the postmenopausal, the emphasis on calcium and vitamin D intake, the emphasis on aerobic exercises right through our lifespan, the newer modalities of treatment, particularly bisphosphonates, calcitonin, parathormone. All of those things should be remembered and every one of us should be available to tackle this problem and should be aware of this dreaded hidden disease, osteoporosis awareness program. This slide in one word summarizes the crux and the emphasis of this presentation. Whatever may be the cost, let us try and prevent fractures.